I think that they needed, this is my rough guess, I can't remember, but you know, I wasn't around at the time. So I was going to ask Simcast if she wanted to come on the show and explain some things that I don't have the answers to. And this could have been one of them, but it seems like she's not interested in doing that now. But if she ever did want to come on the show and I could ask her questions and she could answer them about stuff like this, I'd love for that to happen. So maybe she's listening.
Some people wonder why I'm doing this. And the short answer and the simple answer is that I'm in a very reflective mood and I still see Bam's legacy being continued. The negativity, her influence is, I feel, in our community is still very strong. And because I see that, it leans me towards discussing her and talking about her. And, you know, I still feel that her presence through her most loyal followers, I feel her presence. So I'm in a very reflective mood and I want to discuss that for that reason. And I have also been deeply affected by all that's happened in the months leading up to her leaving the platform and subsequently what happened. I cannot believe to this day that when I befriended her, and I'm going to get emotional in some parts of this. I'm human, and I think it's important for me to show you that I'm, show you my humanness, so to speak. You know, you've seen me stumble and fall, you've seen me make mistakes, and I don't mind making mistakes in front of people. One of the things that I've embraced about myself is that, you know, I say I'm a very unpopular YouTuber. I tell the truth, I'm blunt, I'm honest, and that doesn't always go down well. I think if you embrace your unpopularity and you can even be happy about it, it is better than being on top of the mountain like AD was. You know, AD was always bragging about his sub count, bragging about his views. He looked at other people as the little people beneath him. And Bam was very much like that as well, although in a slightly different way. And he had, you know, his fall from grace was a big one. If I fall and stumble, it's not going to be a huge fall from grace because I've already said I'm unpopular and I can live with that because my life does not revolve around YouTube. I had a life before this and I'll have a life after. So I have nowhere to fall. Bam did because she talked herself up constantly. I don't. I say I'm real, I'm authentic, I'm honest, and I'm unpopular and I embrace it. So I'm not standing on the top of the mountain looking down at other people. I'm just the girl next door. But this is not going to be just about Bam because I'm in a reflective mood. I'm going to interject some personal stories into my podcast from now on. And I'm going to tell you a story before I get going. When I was about 8, I remember going to this school. I would have lost my Jamaican accent at that time. I had a Jamaican accent when I was a kid. And I think I lost it within a year of moving to England. So anyway, this school that I went to when I was about 8 was full of people from foreign backgrounds. I think there was probably only about 3 white people in our class. And it was mainly Afro-Caribbean and Asian students. And one of the students in this class was a boy called Stephen Gundy. I will never forget his name. I was madly in love with Stephen Gundy. He had brown skin, beautiful, smooth brown skin, chocolate skin. He had big black puppy dog eyes. He had jet black hair and he had the most perfect little face. I was just in love, or I thought I was. Of course, it was puppy love. I thought I was madly in love with this Stephen Gundy. And I would go around telling everybody, I love Stephen Gundy. I love Stephen Gundy. I would tell anyone who would listen, his sister, other students, even his family knew at home that I loved him or that I would say that I loved him. His mum and his grandmother used to come and pick him up at school and say, oh, that's the girl that loves Stephen Gundy. I would sit round the table with him at lunch. He might be on the other side. His sister might be to the left of him. And I would just tell everybody that I love Stephen Gundy. Stephen Gundy paid me no attention for months. I thought that Stephen Gundy wasn't interested in me, and boy was I wrong. So I think I enjoyed the thrill of the chase. I enjoyed the thrill of the chase. He completely ignored me, and for some reason I didn't care. I was just in love, or thought I was in love. One day we were sitting in class. At the end of the day, at the end of our school days, the teacher used to read us a book for some reason. And it was afternoon, it was a summer afternoon, and I was sitting next to him, Stephen Gundy. Out of the blue, Stephen Gundy took my hand into his, looked at me and told me that he loved me. He said, "I love you." Oh my goodness, I froze. I was completely shocked. This guy had been ignoring me for months. Now he's telling me that he loves me. He's holding my hand. He's looking at me with these big black eyes. And I froze. I don't even know if I even responded to him. I was silent. I was shocked because I liked the thrill of the chase. I liked chasing after him. I liked telling people that I loved him. I didn't think he had any interest in me at all. So hearing that he claimed to love me now, after all the months of ignoring me, it was just very strange. I will never forget that moment. I froze. I didn't know that he liked me in that way at all. Never said a word. All these months I was telling people that I loved him, he never said a word. And I think after that, I was so afraid to even walk into class to see him. And I was so, you know, you would think that I would have been happy that I'd finally gotten acknowledgement and validation from this guy. But I was frightened. I just couldn't believe it. I was just shocked. And so I became afraid to go into class, afraid to see him, afraid to go into school. Because I had enjoyed the thrill of the chase. I had enjoyed the one being the one that was in control in the driving seat. And now that was gone. Now it was like he was in control. And I didn't know how to handle it. And I think because I was so young, I just didn't know how to, I didn't know how to process that information. I mean, he was so serious. He was serious. He wasn't joking. I could tell by the look on his face. And so I kind of lost interest in him. After that, I stopped chasing him because the thrill of the chase had worn off. Sometimes I wonder, did he always like me, or did he like me and he was just keeping quiet about it? You know, I will never know, but I think that might have been a first sign of my imposter syndrome. I don't know, but you think that would have given me some confidence, but in actual fact, I was just scared, really scared. I may have to cut this podcast shorter and do a second half at another time. But at the beginning, I played a clip of Scott at Battery Exhausted saying that he wants me to come on his show, on his live stream, to answer some questions. And he's made several references to this, that he wants me on his channel. And he's never said that to me personally, but it just seems to be, it seems to be a new desire of his. And it is very flattering. At the same time, I don't believe that I have anything unique to share with him. I don't have any unique information. I don't know anything more than anybody else. I actually think Martin appearing on his show would be a better person for him to interview or talk to than me about this whole BAM situation. Because Martin was there from the very beginning. Martin knew BAM before I did, and he's been in the midst of things far, far longer than I have. And, you know, Martin and I are not friendly at all, and we have very different opinions on the whole thing. We have different opinions on everything, but I do think Martin would probably be a more suitable person to have on his show to interview, because Martin was there a lot longer. I'm really a Johnny come lately. I'm late to everything, you know. It's really been a short, I mean, even comparison to how long Scott's been around and doing his channels, you know, Scott started being a YouTube creator far, far longer than I've been doing it. I've only been doing it for a couple of years. I mean, 4 years, I think it'll be 4 or 5 years, which is really is not a long time, since I started my channel. The other reason why I don't want to participate or be an active participant in Scott's live streams, either in chat or speaking to him via Zoom or whatever, is because I was very active in BAM's live streams. I took part in her live stream chats on a daily basis or whenever she went live for a few months, and I was a very active participant, and it didn't end very well. So because of what happened with BAM, I have really bad vibes. You know, BAM and I used to talk, and then I also participated in her live stream. So I was in contact with BAM constantly. You know, it didn't end well. It didn't end well because we had a personal friendship, and I also participated in her live stream, and I just have bad vibes from that. So I don't want that to happen to me and Scott. Also, the whole Amber and Lycan thing, when she hosted him and they appeared in each other's chats, you know, I just don't think it's a good idea. It's nothing to do with how I feel about Scott. I just don't think it's a good idea at all. I've always thought to myself that he has his subs, he has his fans, he has his supporters, and he doesn't need me in there interfering with what he's doing. And I know that he doesn't see it that way. He probably would like me to be a more active participant on his channel. But I've always thought from the very beginning, just leave him to it. That's his thing. I don't want to get involved. I don't want to, go on his channel acting as if I'm something special. Also, you know, I am aware that some of his subs don't like me at all. They think I'm a drama queen, and that's fine. I'm not everyone's cup of tea. So that's another reason. I mean, there's lots and lots of reasons why I don't want to get involved with Scott's channel. He does his thing and I watch from afar and I enjoy watching him from afar. I don't want to get involved with that. And I hope that I'm not upsetting him. I've upset him recently with some of the things that I've done, and he's upset me with some of the things that he's done. We both upset each other. But, you know, it's very hard for me to stay upset with him for a long period of time. You know, I can't stay upset with him for very long. And, you know, I just never, ever thought it was a good idea to get involved on that side of, to me, that's his business. And I don't want to be up in his business. And I don't want to do anything to upset him anymore. And he might be upset because I've decided that I don't want to take part in his live streams, either as a chat member or somebody he's interviewing. That might upset him. I understand that, because he's said several times he really wants me on his channel. I just don't think it's a good idea for me to do that. What's the other thing? I will say this, though. When I first started on BAM's channel participating, she used to talk about Scott, and at that time I didn't really know who he was. He was just somebody that was new on the scene, the new kid on the block, I called him. And I, you know, there was no contact between us. We didn't know each other. I don't think he even knew I existed at that time. And I only knew him because people were talking about him, and then he was doing the AD stuff, and BAM was very, very unkind to him, as you know what she's like. And you know, Scott and I had no clue. You know, Scott had no clue who I was, and we weren't speaking at that time. I didn't get to know him until long after BAM and I parted ways. But he has done a few videos on BAM, and I have to say that I agree with Scott's perception and opinions of BAM. He's spot on about BAM when he says that she looked for people that were easily manipulatable, and that she didn't like anybody. He is so right, so correct. And I would urge people to go and watch one of his live streams. It's called Bin Bin. He changed the title of the live stream after she, you know, after the update we got on her. But it's called Bin Bin. And at least the first few words. And it's a very good live stream. Now, Scott says and does things that I don't always agree with. But I have to say, his opinions about BAM is absolutely correct. He's absolutely correct in everything he says about her. And I would urge people to go and watch that live stream, which has over 2,000 views. Or I think it has almost 3,000 views now. I was thinking about the word sympathy the other day. Sympathy. Do I sympathize with Bam? I sympathize with her family. I deeply sympathize with her daughter. Her daughter was getting married, and I know that Bam wanted to be there. She was delighted when her when she found out that her daughter was getting married. She was absolutely delighted. She shared that news with me, and she was delighted, and I was very happy for her. Obviously, I had no idea how things would turn. And as a daughter myself, who, you know, my mum is my everything. It, you know, the other day I was having health issues, and my mum, you know, I was really, really moody. And my mum drove out, you know, my mum came to my house and she was knocking on my door and I wouldn't let her in. And I feel really bad for saying this. I feel terrible. And she was, you know, she kept on knocking on my door and I wouldn't let her in. And she was driving through the night trying to find anything that was open that she, so she could buy me some prescriptions. And, you know, she spent so much money on getting stuff that I needed. And, you know, my mum is my everything. And even though we were estranged for 2 years prior to the beginning of last year, and she was the one that reached out to me because I'm a very stubborn person. She was the one that reached out to me, and I decided to give my mum another chance. But the truth of the matter is my mum is my everything. My mum is my entire world, and she is my everything. You know, I'm not close to my dad at all, and maybe I'll talk about that at another date. You know, my mum is the holy grail for me. So I do sympathize with Bam's family, and as a daughter, I sympathize mostly with her daughter because I'm a daughter and I know what that's like. So I do have great sympathy for Bam's family. I don't have the sympathy that I would like to have for Bam. My sympathy for her is very lacking. And I think it's the way she treated people and the way she talked about people that, you know, I think she deserved to be taught a lesson, and that Nottingham Village Bike Channel taught her a lesson. She thought she could talk to people like that, and she thought she could keep going on and going on like that, and she thought that she had the right to do so. And she was arrogant, very arrogant. And I'm so glad that at the end, people had a right to stand up for themselves and say, this is wrong, and we're going to stand up for ourselves, and you're not going to be able to do this anymore. I would like to have sympathy for Bam's plight, but my sympathy for her is lacking. I wish I had more sympathy. And don't get me wrong, there are days when I do miss her. And that's the conflict in me. There are days when I do miss her. There are days when, you know, I miss talking to her. But sympathy for her and how it all ended for her, there's very little of it from my end anyway.